My name is Martha Craig Daughtrey, and I'm in Nashville, Tennessee today, December 16th, 2004, to interview Adolpho A. Birch, Jr. The interview is taking place as part of the Legal History Project of the Fellows of the Tennessee Bar Foundation. Justice Birch, you have a wonderful history of accomplishments, really phenomenal history, but we're going to start this interview with the more mundane, if you don't mind. And so they've asked me to ask you to state your name and your date of birth and place of birth.
Surely. Adolpho A. Birch, Jr., born in Washington, D.C., September 22nd, 1932.
And can you tell us, first of all, something about your family, your grandparents, your
Certainly.
Parents, your
Certainly.
Siblings?
Certainly. My father was born in Belize, which at that time was a British protectorate. British Honduras is what it was called then. Later it's been changed to Belize. And he emigrated from Belize at a young age through Guatemala and through Cuba, and came to the United States and went to Hampton Institute, apparently in the 20s, 1920s, right after the First World War. And he graduated from Hampton and went into the Episcopal Seminary. At that time, they had, as you know, segregation was very, very much a part of life then. And he went into the Bishop Payne Seminary. It was a seminary devoted exclusively to the training of black Episcopal priests. And he met my mother there in Petersburg, Virginia. And they married, and he went to Texas, I think, for a very, very short time and came back to Washington, where I was born. My mother was born in Virginia, Petersburg, Virginia, and she was a public school teacher. I knew my mother's mother. I never knew my mother's father, but I knew my mother's mother. And my father's parents, I never knew, never met. But in visits back there, I have seen some of, have met some of his relatives.
So you have been back to Belize?
Yes. He and I went back two or three times, yes.
Well, that's wonderful.
Yes, it was a wonderful experience.
And what about siblings?
I have one brother. He lives in Washington, in the Washington area, and he's a year and a half younger than I am.
And nephews, nieces, other extended family?
No, I have a cousin. That's all that's left. I have a cousin who lives in Milford, Connecticut, and that's about the extent of the family, at least beyond my generation.
Well, and we're going to talk a bit about that, too. Tell me a little bit about your childhood in Washington, where you lived, where you went to school,
yes.
What your interests were.
Yes. Judge, I lived I call it an enclave. It's really not an enclave, but it's a part of Washington where in the late 30s and early 40s, Caucasian people moved out of the area, and it became a very, very, I won't say fashionable, but desirable section of town for black people to live in. It was called Adroit Park. It's south of Howard University, south of Freedman's Hospital, and just a really nice part of town. Of course, my being raised there had nothing to do with my father's choice of LaDroit Park as a place for us to live. What it really had to do with was the church was located in that area. So I was raised right around in there. I went to a school called Lucretia Mott School, elementary school, which was right on the border of Howard University. And And
here's an interesting question. Did you know who Lucretia Mott was at
yes,
the time?
Good. Yes. Yes, I knew who Lucretia
Mott was. Not everybody does.
Yes, I do. You couldn't get out of that school without knowing who Lucretia Mott was. Beyond that, I went to Connecticut to live with my aunt during World War II. She lived in Milford, Connecticut, and I spent 3 or 4 years there going to the local high school, well, not high school, but middle school or junior high school there in Connecticut.
This is your mother's sister?
My mother's
sister,
yes. Mm-hmm. My mother's sister. My mother died when I was 5, so, you know, her sisters were quite interested in seeing that my brother and myself got some sort of discipline or training.
A little raising up.
Although they didn't have children themselves. And it was sometimes a little
heavy-handed.
Yeah. After spending time in Milford, I guess perhaps in 1948, my father in some way was able to get some sort of scholarship to Mount Hermon School. And that's a school in Greenfield, Massachusetts. And I accepted, you know, his heavy-handed invitation to go. And I spent a year there. After that, I came back to Washington for the 11th grade at Dunbar High School and finished the 11th and 12th grades there.
The year that you were at the school, was that one of those New England prep schools?
It was, but it wasn't like Phillips Exeter or Andover or Choate. It was not richly endowed like the other schools were, and you had to work to help pay your tuition and everything. It wasn't the same thing, but it was along the model of a New England prep
mm-hmm.
school.
And was it, what was the racial makeup of the school?
Well, I guess maybe 10%, 6, 7, 8%, something close to that.
Minority representation?
Yes. Yes.
Was that the first time you'd been in a school that was overwhelmingly white?
No. Connecticut was the first time.
Okay. Dunbar High School, which I think is still in existence.
It is. They've torn down the old school and built a new one there. But it lives on.
And what was the demographic makeup there?
100% black.
Yeah.
Total.
And what did you do while you were in high school? I mean, besides study.
I took part in some of the extracurricular activities. I didn't do as much as I wanted to do because I worked. I had evening jobs, I had a morning job, and there wasn't really much time for me to enjoy some of the benefits of extracurricular activities. But
what kind of work was it that you were doing?
In the morning, I would get up at 4 o'clock, 4:15, and the manager, newspaper manager for the Washington Post, would pick me up in front of my house. He'd take me, I guess, 20, 30 blocks to where my paper route was, and I'd throw the paper out of 150 papers, and he'd pick me up and take me home. I'd get home at 6 or so, take a shower, go to school. And then in the evening, I guess the job that I had I remember best is Western Union. If you all can recall Western Union, it was a telegram company or telegraph company. Mm-hmm. And back then, the telegrams were delivered by young men on bicycles.
That's right.
With little caps and khaki sort of outfits. Well, I had one of those outfits. Mm-hmm. And I
bet you were good looking in that outfit, too.
Well, I tell you, I liked the ease that I could work that job. I'd come home from school, change my clothes, get on my bicycle, go downtown, and start working. I'd work till from maybe 4 or 5 to 8 or 9, delivering telegrams, and come back home.
Well, it sounds like a pretty full life. You were in school all day, working jobs before and after school, probably in church on Sunday.
Yeah.
A lot of preachers' kids turn out to be rebellious. Was there any time or opportunity for you to do a little rebelling of any sort?
I don't remember any rebellion that I felt. I felt, I guess I would describe the way I felt as being really driven to accomplish something. I didn't feel any rebellion. At least I don't recall any.
Yeah. Well, you've always struck me as sort of the straight and narrow guy anyway.
Well, I felt really driven. To accomplish something.
When you went off to college, how was that decision made, and where did you go first?
One of the teachers at the high school told me that the people from Lincoln University in Pennsylvania were giving a test to see whether they wanted to give some scholarships to people, and I said I'd like to take it, and so I took the test, and they offered me a half tuition scholarship, or half a scholarship anyway, and I took it. I guess at that time I was perhaps more in charge of my life than I guess my father was, because I had decided before that you know, it was just up to me, and I would have to make those kinds of decisions, and I did. And I went to Lincoln University for 2 years.
And studied liberal arts?
Yes, liberal arts.
And how did you make the transition from Dunbar to Howard, Lincoln to Howard?
It was an easy transition to make because I was also playing basketball and the coach got fired. And I decided that, you know, it would be too much to try to, there's no place at Lincoln to work. So I decided I had to change, and I just came back to Washington and started living at home and went to Howard University.
Mm-hmm. And finished with honors, studying what, Justice Birch?
Well, I think I came out of law school pretty high up in the class, but I don't think they have any honors on the degree.
Well, but I'm talking about undergraduate school now. What did you study in undergraduate school before you went to law school?
In undergraduate school, I took advantage of a new program at Howard, just newly instituted when I got there, that would admit me to law school after one additional year of undergraduate school. So that means after 3 years total, 2 years at Lincoln, 1 year at Howard, I could get into law school, and that were I to successfully finish, then they would give me both degrees at the same time, and that's what I took advantage of.
Sort of a senior in absentia.
Sort of, yeah.
But while you were in undergraduate school, what was your major?
Political science, only because a guidance counselor told me that was the way to go. And
were you already looking at law school when you made that decision?
Yeah, I wanted to go to law school without question.
And did you know lawyers at the time? What was driving that choice?
I've asked myself that question many times. I really don't know. The only thing I can point to is the fact that there was a lawyer's office across the street from me. And I used to, it was a big yard kind of thing, and I'd go over there sometimes and peek in the French doors, and I'd see all these books. And, there was no television, there was nothing to bring lawyers to your attention very much. So that is the only thing I can point to as evidence of my early interest in law.
While you were in college, what contact did you have with any of the civil rights, early civil rights movement that was going on at that time?
There was no movement when I was in college.
Just no movement.
There's no movement at all.
And so you're off to law school in what year?
53.
53. And there's still not a whole lot of action going on, even in Washington at that time?
Well, the beginnings were starting because Brown against Board of Education had started. The South Carolina case against Clarendon County had started. And some of the professors in the law school
were involved in those cases
and were instrumental in providing for the lawyers who were arguing the cases dry runs, mock trials, so to speak. One of the professors was actually one of the lead counsel, James Nabritz.
Right.
Yeah.
And who there were a lot of teachers at Howard at the time who turned out to have connections with the civil rights movement as it grew and spread. Who were some of the professors that had an influence on you, whether or not they later turned out to be giant figures?
Certainly. James Nabritz, who later became the president of the school for a while. Herbert Reed, a very, very astute lawyer. George Johnson, who was the dean at the time. Charles Quick, a person who taught evidence in a very, very interesting way. And James A. Washington, Jr. All these people were really... they just instilled in me and I guess others the interest and the drive to do something about the way the world was. They emphasized to us that in the mold of Charles Saisty and Houston, that lawyers should do more than simply sit in their offices and draw wills. They need to be social engineers to do something, to accomplish something for the benefit of the benefit of everybody. And
that may have been even unique to Howard at the time.
Yeah. Probably was. It probably was. I have nothing to compare it with, but probably was, because Howard at that time and its professors, its administration, at least law school administration, prided itself on being right out in front of the civil rights movement, although it was not called the civil rights movement then. It was a burgeoning sort of thing, embryonic, but it was on the way.
Did you know Hasty and Houston?
I met Hasty. I didn't know Houston, but I'd met Hasty several times. As a matter of fact, his daughter and I were in Mott School together. Karen, I believe.
I know Karen too. Yeah. So that's a coincidence.
Yeah.
So in law school, obviously, you weren't going through thinking, well, I'm going to join some Wall Street law firm when I get out of here. What were you thinking about as you came through? And what did you have a plan in mind, or was it?
Well, I didn't really have a plan in mind, except you're absolutely right. I wasn't thinking about Wall Street or any big firm, because it just wasn't a feasible thing to think about. I had no plan, and I guess my plan started to develop when the dean gathered, I guess, five or six of what I guess he called better students and talked to them, and he told us that Howard had provided scholarships for us for 3 years or 2 years, and that we owed something back, and that he would like to have our permission to see if he could match us with a lawyer somewhere, especially in the South, where you perhaps would have an opportunity to put some of these desires and efforts to good use or to better use. And I thought about it a while, and you know, I said, well, you know, I do owe the school something. They've given me a scholarship for the whole time. I never had to pay a dime tuition. And I do want to be the kind of lawyer who does something for somebody else. And I didn't have anywhere else that I wanted to go. And I didn't have any desire to stay in Washington because...
Tell me about that. Why not? I mean, I know the women coming out of the law schools at the time were facing a lot of discrimination and flocked to Washington because they had a better chance of finding good opportunities there.
Well,
and it seems like you all were in Washington but leaving and going out. I mean, I can understand the urge to go out, but what was your feeling about not staying in Washington?
Well, Washington for lawyers, for black lawyers, was a very difficult place. If you wanted to work for the government, then you could get, I guess, hired at a salary that was below entry level for others. I didn't want to be the kind of lawyer who has to have an extra job in order to maintain himself or herself. And
you know, I suspect that's what the women were doing too. They were taking these positions at a lower rate than maybe a white male would have gotten for the same job.
Yeah, you know, Washington had a lot of lawyers at that time, especially black lawyers who worked in the post office, who taught school in the daytime and tried to practice in the evening. I didn't want to do any of that, and I really wanted to be in a position or be in a place where at least I had the opportunity to do some good. I never knew what I might do, but at least I knew that I couldn't or didn't want to do it in Washington.
So you headed to?
I headed to the United States Navy. I headed to fulfill my military obligation.
What year was this?
This was 56 when I graduated from law school.
Why the Navy?
Well, Uncle Sam was waiting on me. I'd been deferred all through school. And you remember Korean War was ongoing, and I'd gotten a deferral every single time. And I guess in May or April or May of the year I was going to graduate, I got a letter. They told me, well, your time has come. I said, okay. And they actually drafted me into the Navy.
Into the Navy.
Yeah.
And you spent how long?
2 years.
2 years in the Navy.
Two years on active duty, and I guess another 6 or 7 on inactive.
They say join the Navy and see the world.
Yeah.
What'd you see?
Well, I did get to go to the Mediterranean. I got to go to Italy, France, and Spain, and Greece, and Gibraltar, and I did see a part of it. They fulfill that promise, at least in part.
Out of the Navy, and where then?
Nashville. Right.
And how did that happen?
It happened because the person that the dean put me in touch with was a local lawyer and a sort of real estate dealer here named McClellan, J.F. McClellan. And he, I guess...
Was he a Howard graduate?
He was.
That's how the dean knew him?
Yes, he was. And I had corresponded with him, and you know, to me, it just seemed like it would work. And I came right, I guess, within a month or two after discharge from the Navy, and just started in with him. His practice was more real estate, and he collected rents for people and such, and handled a lot of title work. But I got a chance do what I consider to be a lot of real lawyer work, not involving titles and collection of rents and things of that sort.
Where was the office, Justice Birch?
His office was 327 Charlotte, right on the corner of 3rd and Charlotte.
Close to the courthouse?
One block away.
And was he practicing by himself when you joined him?
Yeah, he was. But I hasten to tell you that he wasn't really practicing a lot of law. He was doing a lot of real estate.
What other African-American lawyers were practicing in Nashville at the time?
Okay, Z. Alexander Luby had an office upstairs at 327 Charlotte. Avon Williams, Jr., Eugene White, Coinus Enix, Bob Lillard.
Most of them practicing solo, or was...
Well, Luby and Williams had, I guess, a true partnership, or the closest thing to a partnership. Mm-hmm. Enix was a solo practitioner. Bob Lillard was a solo practitioner. And then there were several others who did more or less solo practitioner work.
And so... In your first years in Nashville, you were actually practicing law. Tell me something about the kind of work you did, about your clients. Was it difficult to keep it going?
Well,
talk a little
bit. In a sense, because you know you have to understand the climate at that time. While we say generically, I was practicing law. I didn't get the opportunity much to do things that some other lawyers do, like take depositions or to go to circuit court and try an accident case, because it just didn't happen that way. Practice was restricted because obviously only black people would patronize you. And that's, what, 20% of the population. So you really didn't have the drawing power of a lot of high-powered work or a lot of, let's say, high-energy lawyering. So it was not really the same as a white practitioner would have experienced. It was a lot different. But at the same time, it was educational, and it probably got
you into court.
Yeah,
pretty often.
It allowed me to pay the bills and mm-hmm. everything, and it was certainly a learning process too. But I didn't have anybody really teaching me.
Well,
much.
That's the problem, isn't it? Is having a mentor or somebody at least with the form files who's willing to share them with you.
Yeah. I didn't have anybody who was teaching me much. I had to sort of do it, learn it myself.
On the job training.
Oh, yeah, I did.
How long did you continue to practice out of McClellan's
I stayed
office?
With Mr. McClellan for a year. And then I moved to Bob Lillard's office, and I stayed there seven and a half years.
Was there a social life for young professional people, young professional men at the time?
Yeah, I was married and had these twin daughters at that time, and that was my social life. But there was a social life.
Was there any problem attached to the fact that you were not a local person but had come south from up north, so to speak?
I don't know. It's hard to say, really hard to say, because you never know why someone, well, you never know that someone chooses not to come to you because of something like that. I've perhaps picked up just a rumbling or two about, well, he's not from here sort of thing. But I don't think it was determinative of anything.
Well, you came in well educated and well spoken. That must have been a plus with at least some people.
Well, I'm, you know, I don't I don't think it's been a detriment to me. I can't see any situation in which it has been a negative.
Bob Lillard must have become a mentor.
Yes.
There must have been a lot to learn from him because
yes.
he was a marvelous
yes,
lawyer.
Yes, very much. Bob Lillard was a great guy and a good lawyer and a very, very determined man. He was, I guess, a person who believed in the right things and believed in exerting every effort necessary to achieve them. And whenever you think about a man who started off as a parking attendant in a city garage and went from there to the fire department of a city, this city, and on to be a lawyer and then city councilman.
You and really, judge.
Yeah, and judge. You really have a story that is hard to beat.
Well, he was certainly a gentleman.
Yes.
There's no doubt about that. He was one of those lawyers that you, when you knew you were up against him, you actually looked forward to it rather than
yeah.
dreading
he was,
it.
He was a fine man. And incidentally, I don't know, this is just an aside, but a school was given his name 2 weeks ago. Kings Lane School was changed to Robert E. Lillard Design Center.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Very well deserved. And so by the time you finished, by the time you left his office, it would have been 1960 what?
I guess 66, maybe yeah, 66.
And you went from there to the?
Well, I went from Bob Lillard's office to my own office. I
All
had
right.
a solo practice. But at the same time, I was doing part-time district attorney work. And
I thought it must have started about in there.
66.
Yeah.
And then up to 69 when Governor Ellington appointed me to the Sessions Court.
And while you were in the district attorney's office, was Tom Shriver
he
the
was.
District attorney
he
then? He was the one that hired you?
Yes, he did.
And you were you full-time with them at any point?
Yes, I did go full-time with him for maybe a year or so between 66 and 69. I'm not sure of the dates.
So when you started out part-time, was it what, handling cases in general sessions, which is where they usually started people
No,
out?
No, I started with Judges Draper and Leathers.
Did you really?
Yeah. Well, I should say I started with Judge Leathers.
Well, you had an opportunity I didn't have. Well, all right. And so Judge Leathers was in the criminal court. I
yes.
think it was Division One,
yes.
Wasn't it? And
yes.
Judge Draper was Division
yes.
Two. So you really were trying felony cases
yeah.
right off the bat,
yeah.
Based on the experience that you had before you got there, obviously.
Well, it probably has something to do with it.
All right, and the appointment came from Governor Ellington in
69.
To the General Sessions Court. And as I recall, there were, what, three of you
yeah.
at the time?
Gail Robinson, myself, and John Boone.
And tell us a little bit about the transition from being a lawyer to being a judge.
Very interesting. I guess you sort of have to decide. You learn real quickly that you know you have to change things. Things have to change in terms of what you do and what you can't do, the way you regard yourself, the way you carry yourself, where you go, and everything. I imposed some restrictions on myself so that I would not ever be in the wrong place or with the wrong people and such as that. The intellectual transition was not difficult at all. And I didn't run into much opposition, let's say, from Judge Robinson or Judge Boone. They were cordial and not at all uncooperative.
The governor, when he appointed you, was, did you know Governor Ellington, or was this, did this appointment just sort of come out of the blue?
No, I didn't. Well, I had met him before, but I didn't know him in the sense that he was, you know, that I was a political friend of his or anything like that. No, but I had met him. I'm really convinced that it was through Bob Lillard's relationship with the governor that the appointment came.
That old definition of a judge is a lawyer who knew a governor. In your case, it'd be a former partner who knew a governor.
Yeah, that's true.
Everybody has to be brought to attention of the appointing authority one way or another, and Bob Lillard would have been a good friend to have at that point.
Well, I'm convinced that he was instrumental in this.
So taking the bench in 1969, did it occur to you that 35 years later you'd still be a judge? How did you see that? Was that just short term, or did you know?
I didn't really know. I didn't think that far ahead. I was satisfied with what I was doing, and at that time I was content to do it, try to do a good job. And
Had it occurred to you at any point before that you might want to be on the bench?
Yes, but only shortly before. In the early 60s, you know, it's just something you don't think about. I didn't even dream of it. If you had told me in 1960 or 62 or 63 that in 69 something like this would happen, I would not have believed you.
And what was going on? I mean, those were somewhat tumultuous years in terms of the civil rights movement. What was going on in town? Let's think about the period when you were in practice. What was going on, and what part did you have in it?
Well, in 59 and 60 are the years that the civil rights movement really got to Nashville with SCLC and Diane Nash and Dr. King and others. And it involved, for the most part, students from Fisk, Tennessee State, American Baptist Theological Seminary, who decided that they were going to stage sit-in demonstrations at Woolworths, I believe, in order to force barriers down. And they did, and as a result of that, they were arrested, many of them. And my particular participation was the same as every other black lawyer in town. We gave them representation. Of course, representation for them was I guess I use the word loosely, because the city judge wouldn't hear the cases and appointed a special judge to hear them. And you know, somehow or another, I got the impression that no matter what the lawyer said or did, it wasn't going to matter.
Who was the city judge and who was the special judge?
The city judge was Andrew Doyle, who appointed John I. Harris, who was a friend of his and a lawyer, to handle the sit-in cases.
What do you think Doyle's motivation was in refusing to hear the cases?
Political. He simply didn't want to bite the bullet. He didn't want to offend anybody. He
wanted to be reelected.
He wanted to keep all his friends, I guess.
And the special judge, Harris?
John I. Harris.
What kind of a job did he do with the cases?
Well, you know, $50. 50 in costs. That's what he did in each and every case. Even though In many cases, there was no identification, there's no connection of the particular defendant to any demonstration or anything. The fact that they were arrested or had been arrested or were in the area was enough for him.
How demoralizing was that to you as a lawyer?
It certainly was a factor that couldn't make you feel good.
I wonder if having a black judge on the bench, even if that judge wasn't hearing these cases, would have made a difference at the time. Would that have?
I'm sure it would. It would have made a difference. I don't know what kind of difference. I don't know how great a difference, but it would have certainly set a moral tone, I think, for proceedings such as that.
Well, we could jump forward then to 69, and you're on the bench, and your colleagues are being cooperative. Were the lawyers
for the most welcoming? Part, for the most part, yes. There were a few incidents where, you know, I got the feeling that someone resented me because of race. But then again, I thought about it, and it really need not have been racially motivated. You know, when you tell a lawyer no, I don't think that the animus that is generated is necessarily a product of race, necessarily.
Where are you in the history of African American judges in this state at that point? Had there been anyone else? Had there been somebody in Memphis, as I recall?
Ben Hooks had been appointed, and I believe Odell Horton had succeeded Judge Hooks, and I think both of those came before me, I believe. Mm-hmm. I believe.
So you would have been at least number three.
At least. And incidentally, Judge Horton was a classmate, and I think he was in that room in that discussion with the dean.
Judge Kilcrease came behind you.
Yes.
How far behind you do you? Just ballpark.
I'd say 10 years.
10 years, maybe. Yeah. It was quite a while. So you're on the General Sessions bench by appointment in 69, and then that next election was what, in 70?
Was in 70.
70.
Yeah.
Okay, you had to run. And did you have opposition?
Yes, after a fashion. I didn't have any, well, let me see. I had opposition. J.F. Doty ran against me. It was true opposition. I mean, he was out working, but I was fortunate.
Well, you weren't fortunate. You were deserving, I would say. Depends on how you want to put that. But in any event, now that carried you to what, 74?
That carried me. Let me see. That would have carried me to...
When was that next
72?
74. 74, right. Okay.
It did carry me to 74.
All right, and then you had to run again.
I had to run again.
For an eight-year term. All right, and did you have opposition at that point?
Yes, I believe 74 was... Let me see, who ran against me in 74?
Well, you can tell people didn't do well if it's not...
I think it was... I think I had some opposition from another political party in 74 in the general election. I don't think I had primary opposition.
And when, Justice Birch, did you go from General Sessions to the criminal court?
78.
78. And that was also by appointment?
That was by appointment.
And who made that appointment?
Governor Blanton.
All right. And was that... What was the motivating factor there for him? Do you have any idea?
No, I don't, other than I had met him several times, and I guess, like governors tell you, you got a lot of friends.
All right, and tell me something about your colleagues on the criminal court.
Well, you know, they were cooperative. They were very helpful to me. I knew them, and I didn't notice any.
It was still Judge Draper and Judge Leathers. Is that?
That's right.
Is that right?
Because I took Judge
Cornelius's place. Place.
But then again, you know, the geography of that third floor sort of worked against me, because on one end you've got Judge Cornelius, and then on the other end there's Judges Draper and Leathers, and that divide between the two was not only philosophical but geographical also, and
well,
I think I inherited some of it.
They had been working down there on that end of the floor
yeah.
together for a long time
yeah.
in any event.
Yeah.
So almost anybody coming in
yeah.
would have had a
yeah.
sort of an uphill climb. The difference in the kind of work you were doing from sessions to criminal court, talk a little bit about that.
Very, very big difference. Very, very big difference. Sessions court, as you know, is not a court of record. Whatever you do is appealable as a matter of right, de novo, and the workload and the volume, almost an assembly line sort of thing because of the number of cases. And I guess while you put as much time and attention on every case as you need to, you still don't get the feeling, or I didn't get the feeling, that what I was doing was accomplishing very, very much. I just felt sometimes like I was part of an assembly line sort of thing. So the transition was great, because in the criminal court it's really serious business, it's lives at stake, it's all manner of difference.
And what were there one or two cases that you tried that stand out in your mind as a?
I've been asked that question many, many times. I just don't make any distinction. All of them were important. No one has precedence in my mind over any other. If you were to cite one to me and ask me about it, I perhaps could remember it, but
nothing stands out as just being monumental, in other words.
No, with this understanding that they all were monumental, almost, because they all involve somebody's freedom, or most of them.
What do you think your reputation as a criminal court judge was?
I don't know. I've heard a few choice words about it.
You want to share those with us
I'd
from this
not.
Vantage point?
I'd rather not. I don't know. You know, it's hard to say. I don't know. You'd have to get that from somebody else.
So you weren't A.A. Birch, the hanging judge?
I don't know.
Okay.
I'm not.
Not prepared to say, are you?
I don't know.
Did you enjoy the work in the criminal court?
I did. It was working with juries and such, and yes, I did enjoy it. It was on a level, obviously, with more responsibility than sessions court, and I did enjoy it, yes.
It wasn't the rough and tumble that sessions court was, but it was... that had more rough and tumble than the Court of Appeals, where you went next.
Yeah.
What was the decision to make that transition like?
I just thought that it seemed to be a reasonable next step in a progression, and that's why.
Was the academic part of it a draw?
Or? Yeah, the academic part of it was a draw. And the difference in what I would be doing on the Court of Criminal Appeals versus what I was doing at the time on the criminal court was a draw, yes. I wanted to to do more that sort of tested or involved intellect.
You gained that coming on to the Court of Criminal Appeals, but you lost sort of the hands-on, everyday case management, jury management, interaction with the lawyers. Did you miss that?
Yeah, I did. I missed the people. You know, if you're at the courthouse, the Metro Courthouse, Davidson County Courthouse, you see 40, 50, 60 people a day, maybe even more. Have an opportunity to speak to a lot of folks, and I did miss that association, but at the same time, the Court of Criminal Appeals gains you a bit of a respite to sort of reflect on things and be more deliberate in what you do and more, you have time to be
time,
more reflective.
Yeah. It is a luxury that you don't have when you're down there on the trial bench making calls.
You have to react swiftly on the trial bench every minute.
The other thing you have in addition to time is colleagues. You're sitting on a panel of three instead of making individual calls. Yeah. Talk a little bit about that. Was that a plus or a minus from your point of view?
I think it was a plus because you're involved with two other people whose views you have to assess, whose views you have to digest and decide whether you want to agree or disagree. I think it forces you into a different mode of thinking. No longer are you the person who can say up or down. You have to take other views into consideration and decide a case not only on that basis, but on the basis of what others present to you as being their views. And I think it's a plus. It broadens you a little bit. It helps you to understand, I guess, an aspect of law and legal thinking which was foreign to me before.
We're sitting in the Supreme Court building right now while we're doing this interview. It's a building I'm familiar with too, and it couldn't be more different from the Metro Courthouse in terms of your daily surroundings. Did you feel some isolation when you came up the hill, so to speak?
Yes, certainly, because you can walk, as you know, you can walk through some of these halls and you won't see anybody. Yes, I did feel a sense of isolation, but I think it perhaps helped me by forcing me to keep my mind focused on those cases.
And did you maintain ties with the, for instance, the professional groups outside throughout all this time, the bar associations?
For the most part.
Well, I know you're a life member of the Napier-Luby Bar Association, and certainly seen you around the NBA and the TBA, too.
Yeah.
The work on the Court of Criminal Appeals went on for how long?
Eight or nine years until 87 to 93. Six years.
The appellate courts in Tennessee, I mean, there are a lot of states where the courts are geographically cut up, and it's true of the Court of Appeals here in Tennessee that they sit in their own grand divisions. The Court of Criminal Appeals, however, moves around across the state, sitting in at least three different cities, and sometimes I think sneaking down to Memphis to sit.
Yeah.
If you were designing a system, would you continue that practice? What would the intermediate courts look like if you were put in charge of designing them?
I don't know. I think I would retain some of the traveling, maybe not every month, maybe 3 months in one place, or maybe hold court in one grand division for 4 or 5 days and come back to your home base and do that for 3 successive months and then move to another one. I think traveling helps a little bit.
Well, the thing that the Court of Criminal Appeals did that the Court of Appeals didn't do too was to scramble up the panels. Instead of sitting with the same 2 or 3 other people, we know that the Court of Criminal Appeals panels are changing all the time. Was that a plus?
I think it is. I think it is a plus because, you know, you can often mistake collegiality for a compromise of your views. You don't want to disagree with a person you sit with all the time because you may feel that person may be offended or something. I think scrambling the panels is a good idea.
I've also heard judges say on intermediate courts that didn't scramble that they could predict usually what their colleagues that they sat with all the time were going, what positions they were going to take before you even got in the courtroom and heard the arguments.
So. Yeah, that's another problem with maintaining the same panels all the time. They do become predictable.
I wonder if before we get to the Supreme Court, we want to take a little break, if that would be all right with you.
Well, certainly. That'd be fine.
Justice Birch, we're going to make the transition from the Court of Criminal Appeals to the Supreme Court now. Tell us what year that was and talk a little bit about the circumstances that led to that appointment.
It was 1993, and there was a vacancy created by Judge Daughtrey going to the Circuit Court of Appeals in Cincinnati. And Governor McWhirter was the governor, and I guess friends of mine prevailed. It's about the best I know.
And so you were appointed in 93. Did you have to run before the 98 election?
Yes, I had to run in 94. Statewide in 94 on the...
Did they have a retention ballot by then?
Yeah. Tennessee plan.
Right. Yeah. And then you ran again in 98.
Yeah.
And that 8-year term extends for another...
2006.
How does a Supreme Court justice run for election on a retention ballot? Was there any thing to do?
Yes, in my case there was, because I had some very lively and vocal, active opposition, even though no one else's name would be on the ballot. And it came from primarily from East Tennessee, the Chattanooga area, and persons who perceived me as insensitive to victims' rights. And so you simply go to all the places you can go, you meet with all the people you can meet with, and
look for endorsements.
The bad part about it is you have to raise some money, and that's never a pleasurable thing.
The rules, as I recall, prevent you from mounting a yes campaign until somebody has mounted a no campaign against you. Is that right?
That's true.
How long before the 98 election, for instance, did you realize that this group might be coming after you?
A few months.
So you did have some lead time.
I had some lead time and some warning that my colleague didn't.
Mm-hmm. Yes, we're talking about Penny White
now,
who's the opposition to her sort of mushroomed out of nowhere just a few weeks before the election.
It did.
And and there wasn't much time to put up a campaign.
No, she had no warning and no real way to combat it.
Well, I want to talk a little bit about the judicial philosophy that might have sparked the group in Chattanooga. But let's get a little narrative down before we go there. You came on the Supreme Court in 93. The governor at the time was
Governor McWhorter.
Governor McWhorter. The chief justice at that time was Lyle Reed.
Yes,
is that
that's right?
And he remained as chief justice for several years.
Yes.
After that, your turn at chief justice came when?
I believe 96, 97.
Well, I hope you notified somebody of that. That's got to end up on your tombstone at some time. I mean, you were the Chief Justice of the Tennessee Supreme Court, so maybe better get that down.
Well, kids will get it right.
Yeah, they will. There are many firsts in your career. You were, in a sense, robbed of being the first African-American judge on the Tennessee Supreme Court by a short-serving tenure, very short tenure, by George Lewis.
George Brown,
I'm sorry, in Memphis. And that was a Lamar Alexander appointment,
yes,
was it?
Yes, it was.
And I think, as I recall, he was on the Supreme Court for just a matter of weeks.
It may have been just a little longer. I think it was over the summer, perhaps.
Yes. Before the election in August. He then went on to serve on the circuit bench in Memphis. Is he still on the bench down there?
Yes,
and
is.
Has turned out to be a very good addition to that bench. But it didn't keep you from becoming the first African-American chief justice on the court. What were some of the things that were required of you as chief justice that just the other justices wouldn't, for instance, be responsible for? Talk a little bit about what that.
I guess the primary responsibility is setting the agenda for the court, setting the conferences, the dates, running the conference itself, assigning cases, which is a tremendous job. You'd really be surprised how difficult sometimes it is to decide to whom to assign a particular case. Things change so fast. And actually, not monitoring, but sort of mediating, I guess, the conferences which, as you know, can sometimes get fairly contentious.
There are also responsibilities with regard to the judicial system in Tennessee as a whole, are there not?
There are. A lot of ceremonial type of appearances you have to make. A lot of appearances that involve the dedication of a building or a new courthouse or a new courtroom. And also there is the overall oversight of the entire system, from General Sessions Court all the way up to Supreme Court. And the administrative work that is involved in that oversight is really tremendous.
It's fortunate that by the time you got into that position, we at least had an administrative office of the court to help out with all of that, which was a rather late development in Tennessee, actually.
Yes, it was, because one person had been doing it for a long, long time with a staff of three or four people. Now I believe the administrative office of the courts perhaps has 80 or 90 employees, so it has really grown tremendously.
And it had that had happened in nearly every other state in the country before it happened in Tennessee.
Yes.
But it must have been a great support to you
as
the Chief Justice.
It certainly was, and it's hard to be in charge of so vast a group of people without a lot of help.
Without the staff to
to
do it. Talk a little bit about what it was on the Supreme Court that you enjoyed most doing. We'll get to the not so wonderful aspects of the job in a minute, if there are any. Talk about the positives, though. For
I enjoyed the opportunity to formulate a position or an opinion about a particular issue of great importance to citizens of this state, and to, I guess, weigh and ponder that choice over a period of time to the extent that I was satisfied and comfortable with it, and then to advance it in conference and see how it came out. That was always pleasant. And then there's the writing part, which I have come to enjoy, even though in many cases I felt like I was hurried in doing it, but I still enjoyed it.
The old adage about judges don't make the law, they just supposed to find the law, discover the law somehow, falls apart at the level of a state Supreme Court. Those courts, and Tennessee, of course, is no exception, are in charge of the development of the common law. You don't have any choice but to make law. Am I right about that?
Well, that's true, and that's why, in my view, that's why the term activist judge is really a misnomer. I mean, you have to be active in the formulation of the law. And I've heard others say, well, we don't want you to be active in making the law, we just want you to interpret it as it is. But you're really saying the same thing, in my view.
So activist judge is just one of those labels that that sticks to you and doesn't mean much, does it?
No, it doesn't. Just like liberal doesn't mean much, because you can, obviously, as you know, you can be far to the right, far to the left on one issue and far to the right on another. So the label doesn't really, well, I say it doesn't really stick, because it doesn't always apply.
What are some of the negatives about the work on the Supreme Court?
If I were to think about a negative, I guess it would be sometimes the constant travel, the travel beyond hearing cases. We have to travel to swear in new lawyers. Oftentimes we travel to hold the Scales Project, wherein we hold court for school students. And then there's a ceremonial travel where you have to be here, have to be there. And that's really not a big negative. It's probably something I would prefer not to do as extensively, but it's not a negative.
Well, and the court is still meeting in all three grand divisions, which is a little unusual. As I recall, that came about because in the Constitution of 1835, they decided that instead of the lawyers coming to the judges, justices, the justices would go to the lawyers, and actually created Supreme Court buildings in each of the grand divisions. And you all are still traipsing around the state.
We are.
Sitting in all three Supreme Court buildings.
We
which is
are.
Probably a little unusual. Is there any problem with the size of the Supreme Court in your eyes? I know there's been some talk about trying to increase the number of judges from 5 to 7. It's, of course, in concrete in our almost unamendable Constitution. If you were designing it at this point, would you want a larger court?
I certainly would. I think that the business we have is sufficient for 7 or even 9. 7 for sure, 9 possibly.
Would that change the dynamics of the sort of interpersonal workings of the court?
I'm sure it would. I'm sure it would.
Negatively, positively?
I guess some of both. I guess some of both.
It might lend itself to a little better diversity on the court, too.
It would do that. It might do that. It would seem that if you go from 5 to 7, you would take the opportunity to enhance or increase diversity, and certainly to 9. But you know, the political process is all intertwined in it, so you know how that goes.
Yes, it's hard to predict what would happen if you could you could do it. Is it possible to generalize about the differences in the style of lawyers in Tennessee, the cases you hear, East, Middle, and West, or the type of lawsuits?
I think you can. We have more cases in East Tennessee than we have in Middle or West. Few West cases in West Tennessee. We have more workers' compensation cases in Middle Tennessee than we have in East or West Tennessee.
Well, I would think the amount of litigation would be directly proportional probably to population. There are fewer large cities in West, and there are more large cities in East. Why would there be a difference in the workers' comp cases, though?
I guess because of the manufacturing facilities, the plants that exist all throughout Middle Tennessee. There are a lot of them, a lot of factories.
The Supreme Court still has direct appeal jurisdiction over those workers' comp cases. While we're on that, let's talk a minute. There have been methods invoked to sort of get around that. I remember that at one point, something like 70% of the cases on the docket, not 70% of the work, but 70% of the cases were workers' comp cases. Talk about what's being done with those cases.
Yeah, we've moved beyond that into the creation of workers' compensation panels. Each panel is made up of a Supreme Court justice and two special judges, usually a trial judge or a retired judge or perhaps a senior judge. And we hear all the workers' comp cases, so they don't really come to the Supreme Court as they used to when you were here. And we've also instituted mandatory mediation so that every case has to at least have an opportunity to mediate.
The workers' comp cases.
Workers' comp.
And does all of that seem to be working pretty? I mean, in some states that would be viewed as a Rube Goldberg type of arrangement. Is it working fairly well?
It seems to work. It seems to work well. Of course, you never know, or it's hard to assign standards to determine whether it works well. If you determine it in terms of how many cases you have, or whether there's a reduction or an increase, you still don't know what that reduction or increase means. It may be working well, may not.
The remainder of the docket is all discretionary appeals, is that correct?
Discretionary appeals,
except
yes.
I would think the death penalty cases have to be reviewed by the Supreme
Court. We have to review those by statute, yes.
Can you talk a little bit about those death penalty cases? What's it like to have to sit on those?
Well, it's a big responsibility, and you feel just a little more awesome of an impact upon you as you sit on those cases and try to do what you think is the best thing in those cases. But you realize that they are really, really important cases. They are really cases that have an impact throughout the state.
The handling of the death penalty cases around the country, we're seeing indications that the number of death penalty verdicts is going down. You think this is the result of the new DNA testing and the moratoriums that have been placed on the death penalty around the country?
Yes, those are two factors which certainly influence it. I think that DNA and the moratoria for sure have a part in decreasing the number of death penalties imposed. I think that the nation as a whole, states individually, are questioning the continued validity of this death penalty thing. I think that they are wanting to, if they err at all, they want to be on the side, on the side that doesn't involve imposing the death penalty, if there's any question about it.
You've gotten some notoriety by your opinions in the death penalty cases. And I understand that as a judge, you wouldn't want to be pinned down on what your personal philosophy is, but are you satisfied that the death cases in Tennessee are getting the attention that they should get? Are you dissatisfied with the process?
I'm satisfied that they get the attention at our level. I'm not happy with some of what happens in some of the lower courts. But I'm satisfied that when they come to us, they are carefully and very assiduously handled.
One of the criticisms of the death penalty is that the way it all starts is not in the courts, but with the prosecutors who are making the decision about whether to ask for the death penalty or not. What is the situation in this state in that regard?
It's just like you said. It depends on the prosecutor. It depends on whether he or she decides that the death penalty will be sought in a particular case. That decision varies from geographic division to geographic division. It varies from case to case, from prosecutor to prosecutor, so that in some there's no uniformity to it. At least in my opinion, there's no uniformity to it at all. And
well, that would be a negative, wouldn't it?
It would be. Certainly it would be.
Serious.
It would be.
Negative.
And then I've always complained, and I still complain about the protocol for review. I just don't think that proportionality review is set up as it should be set up, and I've said so in almost every case that I've set on.
Is it a good thing or not that the cases are being reviewed now by both the intermediate court and the high court in Tennessee?
Well, I think it's a plus. It is a good thing. It's just another layer of scrutiny, and I think that's good.
Talk a little bit about, if you could, about your general philosophy toward the development of the law and your sort of position on the court. If you can, your philosophical sort of position.
You mean,
on the court.
Where am I in relation to the others?
Well, we know everybody tries to pin judges down on whether they're liberal or conservative. I'm not talking about that so much. It's just sort of a core philosophy that you have about your job and about the work of the court. But if you want to put it in that spectrum. I'm going to let you do it. I don't know
whether what I'm going to say is responsive or not, but I'm a great believer, of course, in the Constitution, but particularly do I believe in the Fourth Amendment. I believe in its active and intense enforcement. Why do I pick the Fourth Amendment? It's just the one that appeals to me beyond the others. And it's the one that I think most people are subject to run into as they traverse this life. I guess I have to say that I believe in the little man, the ordinary citizen, the person who has a real problem with government and struggles to find vent legal vent for it, struggles to find a remedy. I think that that sort of person or that sort of issue particularly commends itself to me. That doesn't mean I'm anti-big business, but it does mean that I have a particular affinity for, I guess, the little man. If we understand the little man to be a person who's not rich and famous and simply tries to do his or her best through life.
Where do you think we are in terms of the civil rights movement here at the beginning of this new century? It's obviously not finished, but the tools are out there. Are we about where you thought we might be at this point? What is there left to do? What legacy in that respect are you leaving?
I don't know. I thought we'd be much further down the road. I'm very disappointed that we're not. I read something, I guess, recently that suggested that when it comes to education, there still remain many, many school districts whose demographics don't show any improvement or change at all. I think that we've moved from a legal front to a social front in a sense, which suggests that while discrimination and segregation in most areas of public accommodation and such is no longer legal, there are other subtle ways to reach, the same result.
Yeah, I, as a former history major, sometimes am tempted to think about what if. And one of the things I wonder is where we lost the dedication to integration that we had. I mean, it's the same disappointment that you have that I feel. Would if Dr. King hadn't been assassinated in 1968, would it have made a difference, do you think?
Well, I think tremendously so, because I think he would have certainly pressed for continued progress, or what he would consider to be continued progress. Somehow or another, it seems like the air's gone out of the ball, I guess. The incentives have disappeared. The introduction of age discrimination and gender discrimination have sort of, while they should occupy a rightful place, they perhaps have diluted the overall push. I don't know. But no, I'm disappointed with it.
Well, in spite of disappointment, do you think there's hope for the future? How long is this whole thing going to take, or is there any way to know?
I don't know. I wouldn't even venture a guess. I wouldn't venture a guess. Beyond my lifetime, surely. And that's sad, because that means that my grandkids are just going to be coming out of it if it takes close to that period of time.
Well, that's a positive note. Let's talk about your grandkids. Okay. And your kids for a while. Tell me about your children.
I have three children, twin daughters and a son. And they all are doing better than I am.
Two lawyers and a doctor, as I recall.
Yeah, they don't write for money. they're ready to flip out their credit card.
Uh-huh.
They had to drop
take
them
you
a hat.
Take you to dinner.
Yeah,
huh?
Yeah. And they're doing well, and I'm proud of them and happy for them.
Your son is a lawyer.
Yes, he is.
A Vanderbilt graduate.
He is.
And he's where these days?
He's in New York. He's a lawyer for the National Football League.
And married?
No, he's not married.
Not married. Still eligible.
He calls himself that.
Yeah. And your twin daughters, one's a lawyer, one's a doctor. Where are they these days?
The lawyer is in Houston, and she's general counsel for Minute Maid. and the physician is here and works for the Radiology Alliance at Baptist Hospital and take care of all that.
Yeah,
stuff.
I think I'd let them take me out to dinner.
Yeah, they can well afford it.
And there are grandchildren?
Yes, I have four. Three of them live here, twin girls again, and a son. The grandson is 7, twin girls are 9, and a grandson in Houston who's 15, I believe.
That was the first grandchild.
Yeah.
And so you get to see the ones here.
I do.
Pretty often.
All the time, yeah.
That's great. I didn't realize there was another generation of twins involved there. Congratulations.
Well, thank you.
That's fun. The family gets together?
Often.
Often?
Often.
Your children, the out-of-town children?
They come here, we go there, whatever. But we do get together often.
Well, in spite of the fact that you didn't have a large family when you were small, it turned out to be a good-sized family that you're leaving as your legacy.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun, too, because, you know, I'd always envied, to an extent, other families that were large and had 2, 3, 4 kids and everything. But this one is really nice.
Let me ask you, Justice Birch, as we sort of finish up here, if there's anything that I haven't asked you about that you were hoping I'd ask about, that you're shocked that I didn't ask about, anything you would be willing to talk a little bit about that we haven't covered?
Well, I'm willing to talk, but Judge, you've covered it pretty well, as far as I can tell.
Tell me, what do you think your legacy is? What do you think you're going to be remembered for when your days on the bench are finished?
You know, I had thought about that. I really don't know, because it's others who make your legacy. As far as I'm concerned, if I can be remembered as somebody who made a difference, that's about all you can do. That would be satisfactory to me.
You've had a wonderful, I've got a list here of all the wonderful honors that you've had over the years, and you must take some pleasure in that, certainly.
Well, I'm grateful that others have seen fit to do that.
I think if any of us could finish up a career as distinguished as yours and feel that we had made a difference, we'd be pleased.
You're very kind to say that, and I appreciate
it. Well, I think you have made a difference. I don't think there's any doubt
about
that at all.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for agreeing to let us interview you today.
Thank you very much.
This is Barry Bernstein. Today is May 23, 2005. I'm in Nashville, Tennessee to continue the interview of Supreme Court Justice Adolpho A. Birch, Jr. Some time has passed since we began this interview. There are a few more topics that Justice Birch would like to discuss, so that explains the change of interviewer and venue. Good afternoon, Justice Birch.
Good afternoon, Barry. How are you?
I'm fine.
Good.
We're glad to have you back for part two.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here for part two.
And one of the topics that we just didn't fully go into during the first interview has to do with that word first. I understand that in your life and your career, you have kind of blazed a trail as the first to do certain things. In Davidson County, you were the first Black public defender. You were the first Black assistant district attorney. You were the first Black General Sessions judge. You were the first Black criminal court judge. Then, on the state level, you were the first Black judge on the Court of Criminal Appeals and the first Black Chief Justice of our Supreme Court. What does it feel like to be the first? And is it a double-edged sword?
Barry, in many ways it is, and I've often reflected on that. And obviously when it was all happening, it gave me a certain feeling of exhilaration and joy. But as time wore on, and as I got older and matured more as a person, I took on some substantially more meaningful aspects. For example, I have always thought that being the first this and the first that was a great honor. And I still think so to a certain extent. But that joy is tempered by the fact that I know that before me there were many, many other people, living, dead, who aspired to and who tried, who knocked on the door, the same doors that I knocked on, but who were denied admission because of their color. And it is only through the efforts of those persons that the door was either opened to me or left ajar for me or left so that I could walk in. And I always pause in my mind and when I talk about it to give honor and tribute to those people who tried hard, but because of their race, because of the times, just were not admitted. And any joy I have is always tempered by that sobering thought.
Did it ever cross your mind when the next opportunity opened up? Because you have moved from one legal position to another, to another, to another, which many people do. But did it ever occur to you that you were doing a job that you really liked and maybe you'd like to stay at that particular job because you were enjoying it, but the opportunity had opened up and society wanted there to be a black fill-in-the-blank at another level, and there was that tension. Should you take that opportunity that was offered because you were going to blaze a trail versus staying in a job you really enjoyed?
Well, certainly that sort of tension existed. I've enjoyed every one of the jobs that I've had, starting, as you say, from public defender on up. And it was really a difficult thing for me to start really in the General Sessions Court because I enjoyed practicing law and I liked it, but I did. I guess I felt a sort of higher calling. I felt that I had to make a sacrifice. And I think the way you characterized it, though, is fair. You say that they, meaning, I guess, higher up folks who take care of all these mundane things, wanted a black person in a different role. And I think that's part of it. So if anybody says anything about affirmative action, my answer is certainly. I think it has been of some benefit to me, yes.
Is there anything else that we need to go over that you'd like to tell us?
Yes, there is, as a matter of fact. Barry, I in the hustle and bustle of the first interview, I neglected, I overlooked the fact that I want to acknowledge a debt of gratitude to the people of Davidson County and the state of Tennessee for having allowed me to pursue the practice of law in these other positions you've mentioned. I've raised a family. They're all doing well. Without the help of the citizens of the state and of Davidson County, I wouldn't be able to do it because most of the positions I've held, as a matter of fact, all of them, except public defender and attorney general, have been elected positions. And the people have been kind enough and gracious enough to continue me in office, and I do want to acknowledge that debt and tell each citizen that I truly, truly appreciate it on behalf of myself and my family.
Well, thank you for adding to our knowledge of you and your feelings about your career.
Thank you very much, Barry.